Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the series of videos I'm recording about LangChain. I will introduce you how to work with LangChain and with structured data like SQL databases, CSV file, pandas data frame and tables. As usual, I prepare an output that later on I will post to the repository. And well, what is structured data? Well, it's data that is standardized in an efficient way that for users to access it. Usually this data is organized in base of an schema where you know exactly the data type, how to in few words how to localize the information on that file, and what does this mean, which data type is, and so on and so forth. So is a way in contraposition with the unstructured data, where it's well just a container and the information is just spread. If you want to say that, well, it's not exactly the same. In that case, you have always some metadata that you can access it and understand before even accessing the data itself. How this information is organized inside the container. No? The container again can be a database, an SQL database, where you have multiple tables. Every table you can get the metadata, understand what are the different attributes of the table. You may know as well how many rows has this table and the data types of every file, etc., etc. Also, it's used for accessing. Structured data is a language like SQL, which allow you to query easily and retrieve and aggregate, update, delete information from structured containers. This is a well-known and very old language of querying the structured datasets. So we will cover today SQL databases. With we will look on a light SQL container engine, which is SQLite, which is freeware, is coming with the package Conda. As you install a Conda environment, you don't need to do anything. You have already installed it on your Conda environment. It's not. I will show you how to install it in a Unix box. We will use as well Faiz, but this is a library from Facebook Meta to do simulated search, and we will use Pandas, which is also a well-known manipulation tool in Python. It's one of the most well-known tool for people who is working in data engineering or or data analytics. Is one of the most used tools in when you are working with Python, obviously. So first things first, if you don't have the SQLite 3, I will show you how to install it. Again, if you have a Conda environment, you don't need to do anything. It's already there. You only need to later on create the database. I hear you give you an example how to install it. Probably you can follow through this. It's quite simple. You need to download this file to create the database that we will use here, for example. If you are in an environment Linux, I'm using Colab Pro. This is under the hood a Linux box. And then on here, you don't need to use, you don't need to escalate to root to install it. With just simply apt install SQLite 3, you install the database. If you are in a conventional Linux box in your home, like the Windows assisted Linux, you can you probably need to escalate to use the command with sudo. Once you have this, you already have this ready to go. You later download again this database. You can download as well other if you want to try. There is some examples to play with, and here there is also the instructions of how to create a database and then on load the SQL in the database. This file essentially is a SQL file, nothing more than create tables in the database and create the different attributes of each table, and also later on load the data. That's all. Okay, we move, we continue, we just install the libraries we need. Here we are going to use again phase CPU. It's possible to use as well a version for GPU, but well, we are working in a CPU based server, so no need to use the GPU version. If you had a very big database, no vector database, probably is better to install the GPU version. Phase again is a tool from Meta that will create a vector database and have the advanced capabilities to do semantic search. We will talk about this later on. LangChain, we also use LangChain Experimental, so not the classes that we have available there. As I mentioned in previous videos, just be aware that this is, as the name says, experimental, and it may change in the future. We mount the drive because I keep in my drive the files that I'm working on, and then we get the key from OpenAI. And well, once you have created the SQL database, the easiest way to access, we have already a class in SQL database, which is just a wrapper or SQL Archimi, which is a library, a well-known library as well to access multiple databases like MySQL, Postgres, Oracle, Databricks, SQLite, and more. So this is a, again, as well, very old library which how to say, allow you access to connect and manipulate and query multiple database provider, multiple engines, and then it's again, there is a library in Python. I have no ground, there is in other languages as well, but well, we are just caring now about Python. And again, this is when you install LangChain, automatically install that library as well. You don't need to install it additionally. So we use a class, as you see, as well as in LangChain community. So this is adopted already by LangChain. And the easiest way just to connect a database, we are not interacting already with the LLM. It's just connecting to the database. You just depending on the flavor, the type of the database, this URI will change. Here you just how to say, specify the flavor of the database. As you see, it's very simple database. It's just a file on your file system, and it's the information inside is structured and organized in different sections inside the file. Other databases are much more complex, and then you may need a similar URI, but most likely, completely sure, you will need user and password or other credentials to connect it. No? So, but the after connection, the how it works, how you query the database, how you retrieve the data, how you integrate the data that you retrieve from LangChain is exactly the same. The only thing that may change slightly is how, but very slightly, to be, is the sentences that you execute on the database, SQL language. So some of them, for example, in my Microsoft MSQL contains their own or custom or proprietary clauses that are really available there. Also Oracle had the same, and then on you will see now as well with this command dialect, the TB dialect is telling the for example here, this is the print, that with this you or we will instruct the LLM how to instruct, or how we will give the context to the to the LLM how to create the query that the LLM will use to query the, or LangChain will use to query the database and retrieve the data. So it will be, you will see later on the notebook, dynamically we are going to build SQL queries according or correct for the or appropriate for the database that we are working on, and then on LangChain we'll execute that queries and retrieve the data, and then on the LangChain together with the LLM and the database, etc., it will give you an answer according to the question that we are that you made. No, essentially the idea behind this is just you are integrating the, you want to integrate information that you have stored in your databases file, structured data, and you want to introduce this into the information loop. Information loop for a Q&A system, for a conversational chatbot, or for whatever you want. No? And then on, the idea is to that of this library is create a prompt which is going to create under the hood an SQL query. This SQL query it will be executed by you by LangChain. It will retrieve data from the database, and then we will see that we have multiple ways to do this, and then on with this data that we extract from the database, the LLM will answer you, the LLM, which is at the end, integrated as well on the LangChain chain. So here the only thing that we are doing is just interact with the database using a specific class that comes with our LangChain library. So here we are extracting, just querying a table. So the easiest way to interact is just create an to use from LangChain the create SQL agent. You have here all the documentation, and also if you are working in this case with OpenAI, OpenAI as well create an agent, a tool which is specifically designed to work with databases. So this is pretty simple to use. You just create the LLM. You use the create SQL agent, you pass the LLM, the database, and the agent type with this OpenAI tool. You can get a look here of what exactly is that. And verbose truth is just to give you all the intermediary steps. No? And then on you just make a question to the LLM. And then here, as you see here, we are using natural language. We have no idea about the SQL in this case, and this is the idea. Just you using language, natural language, you can query a database and get an answer. And then what is again working and what is happening under the hood, the chain is querying the database, understanding the schema, and creating a query according that suit the question that you are formulating, and execute this query, retrieve the data, and build an answer back to you. So here, as you see, you can follow the logs, and at the end, the output, as you see here, we send an input, and the output under the hood, you can see here how it's building some SQL, they get some outputs, they build some answer for you. So here, using this simple, if you are again you are working with OpenAI, you don't need to worry even about how to create a prompt to query the. You just invoke the chain or the agent in this case with a query, and that's it. You don't need to worry about the build a prompt because it's doing internally the OpenAI tools. We here see another example, just follow later on at your own. Here, what more, if you know, obviously you know, because the database is under your control, you may know specific knowledge about the database, the structure, the tables you have, and then you can get, you can create some examples of how you can query the database just to get some context. And then here we are going to use prompt, fuse of prompting, and then you introduce all these examples that of querying the database. It can be two, three, four, five examples on how you will do some queries to the database, and this is giving you some context to the LLM part of what is able to do the OpenAI tools. But just imagine that you are not working with that, you are working with other LLM like Mistral or Llama 2. And then with this, you are going to get a context to the LLM to build an appropriate a query to an appropriate SQL query to query that specific database. This is queries that can be executed on this specific database that we load here. Okay? So once you create examples, we just create a we put these examples, we introduce this example as embeddings in a files vector store, and we use the class semantic similarity search to find to create a selector. The selector, what is gonna do is just when you make a question to the LLM, it will first of all make a similarity search into the vector store and find something that is close to the question that you are making, okay? And then it will retrieve the closest, semantically speaking, queries that satisfies or suit your question. And then on here we create just a prompt. A generic prompt. We are using the class view subprompting, and then on our input it will be the text that we send, the top k similar questions. In this case we are sending three, and a table as example to that you want to query in few words, no? And then you can see here how it looks like the prompt that we will send to the LLM. And then once you have the few short prompt created, we just create this is another method. You can look at the documentation similar to the ones before, and you pass the LLM, the database again, and the prompt, and you ask another question. And then it return you the appropriate query to execute on that database. So here, how many artists are in there? Is taking this context and answering you. Probably we can do something. How many songs are there? Let me execute that again. Yeah, probably this is the we had the prompt, and then. Okay, I suppose that is not already here exactly. So they're from Canada. Okay. That simple than that. From Canada. Okay. Now, what more? Few dynamic few short examples. What we are doing here is, as I mentioned you before, you can connect to different databases, and then there is a slightly different the language to query the database, the SQL language may change depending on the database. And then we introduce here a new input that is Dialet. Dialet, as you remember before, if you look at here, is the type of the database here, DB Dialet, is the type of the database. And then what we are doing here is telling the LangChain which database we are working on, no? And then on this way, it will adapt the prompt to the specific database that we are working on. Here you have the example. And then on here as well, we use this functionality that's also available in LangChain. Usually we use memory buffers to git the LLM the context of what the user and the system answer in previous queries to the LLM. Here using what we are using is agent scratch paths and these placeholders which git as context to the LLM all the intermediary steps that the launching is executing. What is that? If we are querying the database, we extract some information, like for example here the dialect, which is the type of the database. We also may have it may have some tests, whatever. All these intermediary steps and logs that we have of exchanging commands or executing commands with the database are introduced as part of the context that we send to the LLM, and the LLM will use it to build a correct query to execute to the appropriate database, to that database, to a Postgres, to a Oracle, to whatever database you have. No? And you see here, we just pass, we create a with the prompt that we have created just here, and where we just place the agent scratch path and the dialect, we just execute a query, and you can see here how it looks like. No, just this we can do it dynamically. Yeah, I will show you later on how. And then you see here that the prompt now changes accordingly to what. And then you may see here that the queries that is introducing as context or as examples on the prompt are according or built according to the database flavor that we had in Dialect. If you change here to another database, you can make your change. It will change the examples that you have here. Here we just execute. We create an agent here and we execute here the query. Again, how many artists are there? And then on is finally creating the query and executing it to the database. And returning you an output. Here you have another example. It's exactly the same that we just execute, but here just what I'm doing is asking you as the database another question. And again, it's just creating an appropriate query for that specific database. This is done with the, how to say, with the context, executing the dialect, querying the database at the beginning, and then on building a correct SQL query to interact with that specific database type, create the query and execute it, building an answer and returning to you. Here you can get from here the different SQL flavors that you had. And here again we are just creating a prompt for an appropriate database. And here just making again some additional queries. In this case we are using SQLite3. If you had access to others like Postgres or Oracle, just feel free to do it. But it will be that simple, that specified, like here, you don't need to even specify if you are using, for example, like in this case, create SQL query chain, you just pass the LLM, the DB, and in that case, the class, the launch chain, in this case, with this specific method or class is going to understand directly the type of database that you are working on and adapt the prompt and create a correct query to interact with that specific database. Also, we can introduce some constraints to how the, for example, you want to to create the unions or the joins in between tables in a specific way, or essentially introduce some constraints or limits of how to interact with the database. You can do that as well as a part of the prompt, and then introducing the dialect as an input on the prompt, it will adapt all these constraints to the database that you are working on, or to the database that the language is detected. You just have here an example, and then on as well another topic is usually if you don't specify anything, it's returning not only the final query, it's also returning you some intermediary step where that is the input which is not necessary. And if you want to just get the final query to execute into a database, for example, you are creating a chatbot with how to say create for you the SQLs, a complex SQL query to interact with some of your database, you just want to receive the query to execute directly with SQL Archemy, for example. You can do it as well like this. No, you just write a prompt similar to this, and then you introduce the dialect as one of the inputs that you introduce on the prompt. You can establish some limits or some constraints in how to build the query or the SQL query, and you just execute it, and then on you will receive a query. And as you said here, you just run the query on the database, and you just get an answer. But it's obvious the query is built or return it as output of the question that you send to the chain, to the LLM. What more? CSV. CSV is another format, another container, probably most of you are working on. If you are familiar with Excel, it's one of the formats that we usually have as an output of the information that we keep in Excel files. No? Excel file is just a multiple, you can consider like a multiple CSV, a container which you can have multiple, every sheet is an individual CSV file. You can save every sheet in a individual CSV file, and it's comma separated value. This is information that is organized in columns and rows, and then it had a completely a structured format, no? And where you know exactly where is what means the position of column 3 and row X is a data type with a meaning, and this is everything or inside of the CSV file. To work with CSV files in Python, the easiest way is to work with Pandas. Pandas is again a well-known manipulation library for people who is working with Python. So probably you don't know Pandas. It's one of the first things that you need to know to when you are working with data and using Python. And then, well, you just simply open the file, and here we are just I download another file with this from Titanic. This is a well-known experiment that is available on internet. You can find this is not coming in the In the video, I will provide you a link how to download this file, and then we just open the file. There is 887 rows with 8 different columns, and here you have the different columns. Again, the easiest way is that. Then on here, we just either you can later on work with Pandas, that is the next section, or you can introduce this in a database like you are doing here with the directly with the the method df2sql, and then on, you just create, like here we create an engine. The engine is coming from SQL Archimy, is this library I mentioned you before that connect to multiple databases. We just create a new database here with the name titanic.db, and then on we upload as a table the content of the data frame that we have created here with pandas. We upload it to the database titanic.db in a table with the name titanic. So then simple that. Here I introduce, I put it in the try step because if you already have it, you cannot execute it. You need to delete SQL. SQL is very simple database, but well, for some scenarios, it's quite convenient because well, it gives you the ability to execute SQL against a SQL engine, and it gives you all the how to say capabilities and features of an SQL engine, but free and very light that you can deploy even in a smartphone or in devices where the memory or the space that you have there is very very small, and then you have an SQL database that can run in a small device. No? Here we just connect to the database and just make a query, and here just make an example of how to query, but this is exactly the same that we see before. Once you have the information on the database, it's working exactly the same that I explained you working with the database. There is nothing new. Here just is we are asking to the database, to the using the LLM, what is the average age of the survivor in the dataset. Survivor is the in this Titanic file there is a flag, it's the people who was, is the list of the passengers in Titanic, and then there is a flag which tell you if the passenger survive or not survive. And then what is doing here, I asking the mean, o sea, the average of the age of the people who survived in the dataset. So we need to find those that had the average equal 1, and then from those we retrieve the age and we calculate the mean. And this is exactly what it's doing. If you look at here the query, select average age as average age from Titanic where survived equal 1. So it's creating the query, executing the query, returning an output, and then on building an answer and back to you. So the only thing that we did here different is just we open a CSV file. Again, a CSV file is a structured container where we're keeping data, usually created with Excel. You can create it manually as well, but the easiest way is with Excel, save it in CSV, and the sheet that you had in CSV is transformed in a CSV file, comma separated value format. And then on pandas is an extension of the, you can consider that, in a pandas data frame you can have one or multiple tables as well. Easiest way is a additional how to say, when you create a panda data frame, you are having much multiple functionalities to manipulate this data. Once you load the data into the data frame, is something similar to a database if you can consider that, but well, and you have multiple ways to work with the information that you had inside this data frame. The data frame again can come from a JSON file, TXT, can come from the idea is to load information. It can come from a structured data or unstructured data, but finally it is uploaded in what we know as data frame. In this data frame is organized information in a structured manner, and you can manipulate with many, many functions and functionalities that are available on the pandas data frame. For example, like in this case, we take the file that we had, the data frame that we create a lot. So Python as a rep tool is a class in the experimental, is a class which allows you to execute arbitrary Python commands. It's also very convenient, no, tool that is just allow us to execute any Python command. You pass the Python command to the tool, and it's just executing there, no? And then what we are doing here, just to give you some insight, we are instantiating the class with the data frame, and then we just pass this command that is means to calculate the average of this column. And then what is gonna do the launcher in this case is just execute this command. You want to say here how it works. We use the bin tools, which is a method in the chain class. We pass the tool, we give a name, and we invoke the tool. So here I have a data frame, and I want to know the correlation between age and fair colon, no? And then on, what is doing this exactly is providing a command to execute what you are asking here. So here you use the natural language to, you want to know something, you have a data frame with this name, it doesn't need to match with this, you can write another one. Here when you build the object is where you have to assign the data frame you want to query, but here you just get a name and you just specify what you want to do. And then on with the Python as replitude and together with the LLM, it will build the appropriate Python command, execute it, and giving you an answer. Here we just say which query, which function is going to return you, and is correct. And later on we are going to see how it works, no? Another way to do this is simply using the OpenAI tools. That is the easier way. You don't need to even do the or use the Python as replit tool, no? You just simply create use from experimental as well, this create pandas data frame and agent. Just simply use the OpenAI tools and this method, LLM, data frames, and the agent, and you just pass the query to the LLM, to the chain in that case, and you just get the answer. You just have correlation. In this case, is you can even do multiple questions, chained questions, and then on all of them means to create or to execute some commands in Python against the data frame. And then on, as you see here, is invoking this query, correlation of these two attributes. Here the correlation of these attributes. Here you get a number, here you get another number, and then on it building the answer. This is when they finish the change. And then you make this input, and then the output is giving you the answer after the calculation. Is this, the other, is this, and here it make an statement. No? So just and see the power that this has. Is a very powerful introducing this kind of tools, no, that allow you to interact with different containers, querying databases, querying CSV files, querying other types of files that you can upload into a pandas data frame. You can execute commands. You just need to specify what you want to do in natural language, and then on this natural language is transformed in appropriate commands in Python to interact with that specific container, execute the commands, return a value, and you can do even more complicated calculations, and those calculations later on are used to build you a correct answer. Again, this is widely used at the time that you are working with Q&A or chatbot systems or conversational chatbot, and it's the way to you interact with dynamic data where some, for example, client is interacting with the bot and they know, for example, they want to know, for example, what is the status of my order. So I'm the client ID, blah, blah, blah. I make an order the day, blah, blah, blah. And well, I want to know what is. This can be solved, for example, connecting to the database of orders, retrieve the appropriate data from this client, filtering by the data the client provide, and it hit one or two orders, and you can provide the status of that orders to the client back. Well, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you like and enjoy with the content, and as I say usually, if you like the content, just give me a like, and if you are not subscribed to the channel, it's now time to do it. Thank you very much. See you soon.